Swing back to Chaz's hotel. Swing back to Chaz's hotel. Swing back to Chaz's hotel. Swing back to hotel. Let there be. Thank you.
Friends, if you don't have a church home, we would love to invite you back as in all of our Treasure Valley churches, synagogues, mosques, and temple. We are grateful that you are here tonight. My name is Rob Walters. I am one of our pastors. On behalf of the Reverend Dr. Dwayne Anders and Debbie Coots, our clergy, as well as our entire staff, we welcome you to the beautiful sanctuary of the Cathedral of the Rockies. Friends, it's hard to believe that tonight is the anniversary, the 100th anniversary of Boise Music Week. Can we celebrate that together? Church Night is organized by Bill and Corolla Winkle, and we are grateful for them and their hard work to put this together tonight. You have already heard Dr. Mark Hansen, the organist from Boise State University, and you just heard the amazing Opera Idaho Children's Chorus. Weren't they fantastic? Woo! You're in for much more of a treat still tonight. Tonight we will hear from the Boise Philharmonic Master Chorale, which will bless us, and the Kevin Kirch Jazz Ensemble will close our night. This will be an amazing night of music. You also get to hear from my friend and colleague, the Rabbi Dan Fink. He is a faith leader in our community and also a speaker for justice, not only here, but beyond our city. We're grateful for his message tonight. Welcome to Church Night. Would you join me as we start with prayer? Holy God, you were called by many names by diverse people of faith. Some choose to use no spoken name for you at all, to show love and respect for you. Thank you for the gift of music, music that instills passion in our hearts, music that bridges divides in a broken, violent world, and music that helps us see your love and grace. Bless those who hear tonight. Bless the musicians that share tonight. Bless the families and the parents and the relatives and the community that comes. Bless those who organize and lead and conduct and accompany. But most importantly, call us to bless you as your people with the way we serve and love each other. We offer the gift of music that you have given to us, and now we give it back to you. In the holiest of names we pray, and all of God's people said, amen. Friends, the president of Boise Music Week blesses us with all of the organization of this amazing music tonight. A retired music teacher, she taught many students to love and cherish the gift of music. Will you please welcome Bev Schumacher.
Was exactly this. Choruses made up of our community members, children, adults, and great talent who come together to create something wonderful so all can share. And we are just so proud to have been able to keep this tradition going. And this is actually the 101st performance of Music Week. And so we're just so thrilled. And without the support of our local community, it wouldn't have happened. So let's give a cheer to our community.
Good evening and congratulations, or as we would say in my tradition, mazel tov on 100 years. It is a blessing and source of strength to our community. I want to add my thanks to Bill and Carola Winkle for inviting me to be here, which is a great honor. begin with two stories about the power of music. The first comes from the memoirs of Russian composer Dmitri Shostakovich. He speaks of how in the mid-1930s, the Soviet government called for a convention of Ukrainian folk poets, mostly blind musicians, who would wander the countryside singing of the past. And so they gathered to discuss their future under Premier Stalin's guidance at the first and last all-Ukrainian Congress. The poets sang their ballads and were immediately packed into cattle cars, taken into the forest, and shot into ditches. Their bodies were covered with lime and earth. Their musical instruments were burned. The second, very different story, comes from Bruce Springsteen's recent Broadway show, where he recalls the night he first saw Elvis Presley live on the Ed Sullivan Show. He says, "Sunday night, 1956, in a cold water flat in the mind of a 7-year-old kid, the revolution had been televised right under the noses of the powers that be, who, if they had known what was actually happening, would have shut it down. Because we, the unwashed, the invisible, the powerless, the kids, would want more, more life, more hope, more love, more truth, more power, and more soul. The joyful, life-affirming, hip-shaking, mind and heart-changing, race-challenging, and soul-lifting bliss of a freer existence." Two stories from two very different musicians, one a tragedy and one a celebration, but both make the case for music as a revolutionary force and scourge the despots and totalitarian regimes of every variety, right and left, sacred and secular. Dmitri Shostakovich in Moscow and Bruce Springsteen in Freehold, New Jersey, both knew the truth, and we know it too. Tyrants and oppressors fear and loathe music. The aversion isn't new. Plato's Enlightened, but also Authoritarian Republic, forbids the playing of several modes of music. Repressive strands of nearly every major religion have banned and restricted music and dancing. And as Edward Rothstein noted in his 1981 essay, "Musical Freedom and Why Dictators Fear It," treason is heard in musical dissonance, sedition, and harmonic modulation. The more tyrannical a regime, the more it seems to fear music. And here is the crux of the matter. The tyrants are right. The danger they see is real, for music really does possess the power to resist oppression. There is something radical about music of all kinds that enables it to tear down walls and fences. Sometimes it's easy to see in the radical, explicitly political music when Sam Cooke insisted that a change is going to come, or Bob Dylan warned that a hard rains are going to fall. Everybody could understand that, though not necessarily agree with it. But music's power runs deeper than the lyrics. Sometimes it is its mere ability to express and embrace the range of human emotions and experiences that is enough to unnerve the despots. And so tonight it is worth exploring briefly this mysterious power of music, dearly needed in our own time and place as ever. Let us ask ourselves, what is it about music that makes it so subversive of tyrants and totalitarians? For starters, despots despise differences. While music embraces and depends on them, tyrants hate the other. They seek to be rid of it, of us, of immigrants, refugees, foreign influences. Listen to the words of Haman, the villain of the Book of Esther. "There is a certain people dispersed among the peoples in all the provinces of your kingdom who keep themselves separate. Their customs are different from those of our people. They do not obey the king's laws. It is not in the king's interest to tolerate them. From 2,000 years ago were the headlines today. But music, any music, at least any good music, loves outside influences. Thus, a composer, a Russian like Tchaikovsky, can write a Spanish dance into Swan Lake. Rock and jazz bring the music of slaves across America and into the world, incorporating local sounds, whatever and wherever they are. Well, I promise to be really quick with the banjo. Not too much banjo. Just a minute. For a change of tone, listen. That is the opening of a classic fiddle tune called Old Joe Choir. Comes out of the Appalachian Mountains, but was born in the folk music of Scotland and Northern Ireland, and played on the banjo, which came with the slaves out of Africa. Played, I add, kind of badly by an American rabbi with roots in Lithuania. You mix it all together, and you get diverse influences creating something beautiful. Across the wall, across the board, across the styles and types of music, totalitarians fear dissonance, but music turns dissonance into something beautiful. Desperate binary, us versus them, our truth, their lies. But music won't have it. Tyrants hate complexity, music celebrates it. Listen to Bach, to the intricate variations weaving together beyond what most of us mere mortals can grasp. It's true to life, which isn't either or, but both and. Similarly, Shostakovich once said that his ideal of music was embodied in Jewish folk songs. For as he put it, the Jews were tormented for so long that they learned to hide their despair. They expressed despair in dancing. One more little instrumental break.
Look at a list of the anthems that propelled the quest for equality for
said if I can't dance, I don't want to be in your revolution. Tyrants want to keep us still and in our place. They hate music because they know all too well that once we start moving, we won't stop. Last but not least, totalitarians rightly fear music's ability to gather and embolden us in community. From the beginning, people have sought courage through song. Henry David Thoreau wrote that when I hear music, I fear no danger. Bernice Johnson Reagan would agree, a founding member of the Freedom Singers, young African-American musicians who sang at countless civil rights gatherings and protests, including the 1963 March on Washington. Ms. Reagan says that for the demonstrators who literally risked their lives, facing down brutal white supremacists, music gave them strength. Singing the songs of the black church conferred upon them a collective concert strength. She says the music created a kind of protective barrier between the demonstrators and the police, allowing the marchers to move beyond their fear. As she describes it, those songs do something to the material you are made of. The singing connects you with a force in the universe that makes you different. You become part of a community, and then they can't get to you. We at the Red Sea, as we march forth into freedom, from the slavery of Egypt toward the promised land, there too we sang, passing through the waters that might have folded back upon us at any moment, we sang to give ourselves courage, and then we were not afraid. Make no mistake, tyrants and totalitarians fear music for good reason. They are evil, but they're not stupid, because music is powerful. And it is, in the best sense, and should always be, dangerous. And so, my friends, tonight and through this week and beyond, let us listen and let us sing together. Let us listen and sing to embrace our differences. Let us listen and sing to celebrate the complexities that contain multitudes. Let us listen and sing to move and to be moved. And let us listen and sing to be strong and of good courage. The kind of courage Moses imparted to Joshua 3,000 years ago, in which we dearly need today in Idaho and across our nation and our world. Let us listen and sing in the spirit of the words my ancestors sang while crossing the Red Sea, a freedom song whose power has not diminished one bit over the years. Oh, Yeshua.
Thank you.
Good evening. On behalf of Kevin Kirk and my musician friends, we thank you for coming tonight. And because we are the last to share with you, we would like to give you our benediction. It's Jude, the book of Jude, verses 24-25. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling, and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both now and forever.
Thank you. Thank you. So right.
His truth, his love, is what we're in, his grace, his truth.